الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم All praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In today's lesson, we would first commence by giving you a little bit recapitulation of what we have covered thus far in the first lesson. So we did discuss before about the hadha in lesson 1, and when we went to lesson 2, we discussed about dhalika. And in lesson 3, we did introduce sentence, and this is the nominal sentence. So in the first lesson, we did cover the pronoun hadha, the demonstrative pronoun ismun ishara, which is used to point to an object that is near. When you are pointing to something that is near, we say hadha. When we want to point to something that is distant away, we say dhalika. So in the first lesson, we covered the masculine hadha, and all the nouns that we covered was masculine. Hadha baytun, hadha masjidun, that's what you have noted. Now what we need to remember, for example, when we speak about the language, Arabic language, just like how in English we have 8 parts of speech, like in English you have nouns, verbs, adverbs, conjunction, pronoun, adjective, interjection, in the Arabic language there are 3 parts of speech. In the Arabic language there are 3 parts of speech. And what are they? Ismun, fa'lun, and harfun. So repeat after me. In the Arabic language there are 3 parts of speech. Ismun, fa'lun, harfun. Ismun is a noun, fa'lun is a verb, and harfun is a particle. So these 3 parts encompass all 8 parts of speech in the English language. This is amazing. So like in English we said we have noun, verb, adjective, conjunction, adverb, pronoun, preposition, interjection. But when you speak in Arabic, it encompasses all of these. So, ismun, fa'lun, harfun. Noun, verb, and particle. Ismun, under ismun, noun, we also have damirun, and damirun is pronoun. And we also have na'atun sifatun, which is adjective. And we also have zarfun, which is adverb. And we have ism al-fi'li, which is interjection. Okay, so this is important. As I said, in the Arabic language, there are 3 parts of speech. The first is ismun. Okay. So when we're speaking about ismun, this is normally the noun. Noun, what are the 3 parts of speech? Yes, noun, verb,
particle.
And particle. So verb in Arabic is fa'lun. Okay? And particle in Arabic is harful. So this broadly covers the part of speech in the Arabic language. So whatever you utter, whatever you speak, kalima, lafzun, the word that you speak. So this lafz, this kalima, whatever you speak, is either going to be ismun, fa'lun, harfun, noun, verb, and particle. But we said that these, like in English, we have, adjectives. So when in the Arabic language, whenever an adjective comes, it also comes under that part of speech, which is noun. So just understand it in that context that there are three parts of speech in the Arabic language. Ismun, fa'ilun, and harfun. So give you an example of a damirun, which is a pronoun. So now you have a pronoun here, and this pronoun is hadha. So therefore, when you're speaking about parts of speech, we broadly say it's classified into ismun, fa'ilun, and harfun. But now you may ask me, what is hadha? Hadha is pronoun. Okay, but we will put it under the nouns. And also you will have describing something when you want to qualify a noun. It is a noun, but now you want to qualify something. So that is called in Arabic, normally pronoun is damir. And when you are describing something or you're qualifying a noun that is qualified, what you use adjective. Okay, so adjective in Arabic, you could say it is na'atun. Be useful to get used to the Arabic terms. And in Arabic, you would have also adverb. Adverb, which is zarfun. Okay, for the verb, we will be discussing the verbs and the classification of verbs that will come. And then you have harfun. Harfun is a particle, and sometimes the particle is harfu jarrin, which is the preposition. Okay, preposition. So preposition is harfu jarrin. And one other harf that we had covered when I said to you ikra waktub, that waw is harfu. Harf means particle, but that we call it conjunction, so that is harfu atfin, conjunction. Okay, harfu atfin. So what is important to understand, we have just broadly given you the parts of speech. Generally we will say parts of speech is ismun, fa'ilun, and harfun. But now sometimes you may find a pronoun, then you may find a na'atun, adjective, you may find a zarfun, you may find it also ismun, interjection like ismun fa'ili that will come, and verbs. You see, one is saying noun. What is a noun? Second is a verb. What is a verb? And how do you distinguish between a noun and a verb? How do you know that this is a noun? How do you know that this is a verb? Okay, so these examples will come. Now, in the first lesson, we did cover and we gave you the example of hadha. Baytun. So hadha is a pronoun. What type of pronoun? Demonstrative pronoun. That hadha is used to point to an object that is near. Zalika is a pronoun, but zalika is used to point to an object that is distant away. So first is to remember that we have ismun, we have fa'ilun, we have harfun. And this ismun, if you're using a pronoun, this pronoun is like a substitute of the noun. Different types of pronouns. We're going to learn ismul most relative personal pronoun. So there are pronouns of different types. And adjectives, it's also a noun, but these adjectives have separate rules. So when you are describing a person, describing anything, that's called na'atun. And then you will discuss zarfun. So for now, the first thing to understand in the Arabic language, three parts of speech: ismun, fa'ilun, and harfun. And now, in Arabic, these parts of speech, as I explained to you, ismun includes zamirun, نعت ظرف and in Arabic language this ism is either going to be okay remember the two terms one is ma'rifa and the other is nakira okay in the Arabic language the ism is either going to be yes ma'rifa or nakira ma'rifa or nakira so what is ma'rifa ma'rifa means definite and nakira means indefinite okay you will see why this is important in today's lesson so what we have explained first is that any word in the Arabic language is either going to be any word you have, parts of speech is either going to be ismun, fa'lun, and harfun. Now when we are discussing about ismun, know that this ismun is either going to be ma'rifa. So when we say ma'rifa, what does ma'rifa mean? Ma'rifa simply means it is definite. And nakira means it is indefinite. So the word baytun, is it ma'rifa or nakira? So if I say to you, ahaza baytun. Okay, so why is baytun nakira? Okay, this is a house. So why is it nakira? Because it's indefinite, that's why. Okay. That's tanween at the end. So very good. So whenever you find an ismun that has tanween at the end, just remember you translate it as indefinite. Meaning, this is a house. Hadha baytun. Why it is important? Because if I change any word from nakira to ma'rifa, then what's going to happen? I'm going to add at the beginning al and then you're going to have your bait but at the end you're not going to have a tanween you're going to have just a dhamma so now if I say to you hazal bait the translation of this will be this house If I say to you, Haza Baytun, translation will be, this is a house. That is why you need to remember that a word can either be Ma'rifa or Nakira. If it is Nakira, translate it as a house. If it is Ma'rifa, Ma'rifa means you are referring to a specific house. Haza Baytun, this house. Haza Baytun, this is a house. And another thing is, the sentence is not complete with this. Okay? Because hadha bayt, this together is part of a sentence. What about this house? Hadha bayt, you can still ask, what about it? Ba'idun, it is far. So therefore, it's important just to know the difference between Hadha baytun and hadhal baytun. So, when we look at the third lesson, ad-darsu al-thalithu. Read after me, ad-darsu al-thalithu.
Ad-darsu al-thalithu.
Okay, now who can tell me, is ad-darsu, is it ma'rifa or nakira?
It's ma'rifa.
Yes, why is it ma'rifa?
Because it's for alif lam.
Ad-darsu. Can you see? The lesson. Which lesson? الثالث. So what did we learn from here? That الدرسو has alif lam at the beginning, الثالثو, because الثالثو is na'atun, it is adjective. It is describing the lesson. It is the third lesson. So therefore, it has to agree. Another rule is that any noun that you qualify, it has to agree. الدرس معرفة الثالث معرفة. It has to agree. Okay, so you have alif lam here and you have alif lam here. So we came to the third lesson. And in the third lesson we learned that if you change a word from nakira to ma'rifa, all we have to do is precede it by alif lam. So translate, baytun?
Al-baytun.
Yes? Baytun al-baytu, yes. From nakira to ma'rifa. Our house, the house. Kitabun?
Al-kitabun.
Al-kitabun. Qalamun?
Al-kitabun.
Jamalun?
Al-jamalun.
Al-qalamu maksurun. What did you understand by al-qalamu maksurun? So al-qalamu, is it ma'rifa or nakira?
Ma'rifa.
Why is it ma'rifa?
Al-qalamu.
So you got alif lam at the beginning, very good. So now translate al-qalamu.
The pen.
The pen. What about the pen?
Spoken.
It is broken. So now we learn that if the first part is ma'rifa and the second part is nakira, then here we have a sentence. But if I had said to you al-qalamu al-maksuru, then this is not a sentence, because now you will translate it as the broken pen. So see how or what is the structure of a sentence. The first part of a sentence, and this is what type of sentence? This is a nominal sentence. So the first part of a nominal sentence, yes, is ma'rifa. The second part of a nominal sentence is nakira. So remember this, a golden rule. That sentences are of two types. One is al-jumlatu al-ismiya, means the nominal sentence. The question is, if I ask you, what is a nominal sentence? A nominal sentence is that sentence which begins with a noun. So remember this. Write it down. Okay? Ad-darsu thalisu. The third lesson, lesson 3, we are discussing sentences now. So the first part of a nominal sentence, what is it called? It is called subject. So remember this. The second part of a nominal sentence is called?
Predicate.
So the rule is, the subject of a nominal sentence is? Ma'rifa. The predicate of a nominal sentence is nakira. Okay? Ma'rifa, alif lam. Nakira ends with tanween. So this is a complete sentence. It is jumlatun mufida. When you listen to the sentence, you get a benefit. You understand the meaning. Al-qalamu maksurun, the pen is broken. So the rule is, and all of these sentences, once you understand one, the rest of it, inshallah, will be exactly the same. So just remember, that sentences are of two types. Right now we are discussing a nominal sentence. In Arabic we say jumlatun ismiya. Not a verbal sentence, nominal sentence. So the rule of a nominal sentence is the first part, which is the subject. And in Arabic, subject is called mubtada. Mubtada. And in Arabic, predicate is called khabar. Khabar. So So khabar is giving information about the subject. What about the pen? So the subject of a nominal sentence, you can write in brackets, is called mubtada. Okay? be useful to get used to the Arabic words. So the subject of a nominal sentence is called mubtada. Say mubtada. And the predicate of a nominal sentence is called khabar. Know how they say akhbar, news, khabar. So the subject, the mubtada, is always ma'rifa, and the khabar is always nakira. Now it will be easy for you to do the translation of all the sentences. So if you look on your book, lesson 3 on page 17. Al-babu maftuhin.
Al-babu
maftuhin. The door is
open.
So you know why it is translated as the door is open. Al-waladu jalisun. The boy is sitting. Wal mudarrisu. What is wa?
And.
Yes, in this end, wa is harf
atf.
Particle, harf atf. Okay, so now you know. Al waladu, the boy, jalisun is sitting. Wal mudarrisu waqifun. And the teacher is standing. Yes, who can read the next sentence? Yes, mashallah. Masmuka, what is your name? Yes,
Aslam.
Aslam, mashallah. Aslam, can you read for me the next sentence? Ikra. Very good. Excellent. Al kitabu jadid wal qalam qadim. I know it's vocabulary. Can you translate?
The book is new.
MashaAllah, brother Asif has been revising. Okay, very good. The book is new and the pen is old. Excellent. Any questions? Now, there's something I want to bring to you, but I don't want to give you too much because I don't want you to disappear next week. So slowly, slowly, inshallah, you go home and then you have your coffee, tea, and have digestive biscuit. Digest all the rules. So slowly, slowly, inshallah, al-himaru. Yes, that boy at the back. What is the meaning of al-himar?
Donkey.
Yes, so can you read the sentence?
Al-himaru saghirun wal-isanu kabirun.
MashaAllah. Very good. Translate.
Himar, the donkey is small and the horse is big.
Yes, the himar is saghir and the hisan is kabir. Excellent. Jazakallah, Zakaria has been revising. Very good. Al-himaru saghirun. The donkey is small and the horse is big. Any questions? You understood the grammar of it? Question, yes? Any question here? Go next page. So is that clear?
Done the pen is broken and you've done that sort of nominal sentence stuff.
Yes, yes.
Would you mind just doing one other example?
Another example, yes. I hope not the one with the donkey. Which one you want?
Whatever's easier for everyone.
Okay, another example. Okay. So what we are discussing here is the noun, and we said that when we are discussing a sentence, first is that every word, every kalima is part of a speech. And that kalima can either be ismun, fa'lun, or harfun. Now you have a sentence. For example, let's take the next sentence. Al-kursiyu maksurun, the chair is broken. Al-ma'u baridun, the water is cold. And I like this sentence. Al-qamaru jameel. Yes, what is the meaning of al-qamar?
The moon.
Yes, brother, what is the meaning? Who knows what is the qamar? Okay. Have you seen the moon?
Moon sighting.
So, yes, you need to go to Al-Qamaru Jamilun. Okay, and I made it clear that you must know the difference between Al-Qamar and Al-Hilal. So don't get confused. Al-Qamar means moon. And just on the side note, just write there, Al-Hilalu. Hilal means crescent. Okay, there's a difference between moon and hilal. Al-Hilal means it's a moon, but it's called a crescent moon. So what is Al-Qamaru? In this sentence, is it what type of sentence? First, remember that if the first part of a sentence,
subject,
which is the subject, so we can put it in this way, the subject or the first part of a nominal sentence is called mubtada. And another thing I want to add is another rule here while we're explaining another sentence. Al-Qamaru is the subject, Jamilun is the predicate. Okay? The subject of a nominal sentence is always definite. And if a word is definite, so if you have the word unni al-Qamaru, definite means ma'rifa. Okay, ma'rifa. So what is ma'rifa? You are referring to a specific noun, and that noun is definite, like al-qamaru the moon. What about the moon? It is jamilun. So jamilun is nakira. Okay, so remember that the subject is ma'rifa, and ma'rifa means definite. And nakira means indefinite. Now there's something else we need to remember. There are three vowel signs in Arabic. And what are the vowel signs? Fatha, Kasra, and Dhamma. Sukun, it is a sign denoting the absence of a vowel. So, in the Arabic language, you either have fatha, and fatha like how you say not like in English, So with the sound, like the fatha, yeah, okay? Or you may have another vowel, which is called kasra, okay? Like how we have hilal, this is kasra. Or it can either be a dhamma. So remember, there are three vowel signs in Arabic. What are they? Fatha, kasra, and dhamma. So now what if any consonant doesn't carry any vowel? What is it called? It is called sukun. So remember, a sukun, it is a sign denoting absence of a vowel. So any word in the Arabic language will either have a fatha on it, any consonant. Meaning these are the three vowel signs in the Arabic language. Arabic letters are 29. In Arabic also, when we are discussing about the sentence, so just remember another important rule, that the subject of a nominal sentence is, the word is marfu'un. Okay? And also the khabar predicate of a nominal sentence is also marfu'un. What is marfu'un? Marfu'un, it means it is in a nominative case. Just remember this for now. That the subject and the predicate of a nominal sentence is marfu'un. Marfu'un means it is in a nominative case. So to simplify it, for example, we said in Arabic there are three parts of speech, ismun, fa'ilun, and harfun, and also there are three vowel signs in Arabic. Okay? So if there are vowel signs, so for example, al-qamar, here the vowel sign is a dhamma. And the reason why it is a dhamma is because all the subject of the nominal sentence are marfu'un, so marfu'un with a dhamma. The jamilun is also the khabar of the nominal sentence, and all the khabar of the nominal sentence is marfu'un, and marfu'un means with a dhamma. Okay, for now understand it. Later on we will go into the other cases. Now, just like how you can find that somebody may have a different mood. Sometimes the person is happy, so he's smiling. Sometimes he's serious, like Ali. He's not happy, he's not sad, he's in between. So we can just say he's, I don't want to use the word, but straight, I mean. Yes, and sometimes if somebody is sad, what do we say?
Upside
down, okay. Is that okay? So it's like three moods. Sometimes happy. Okay. Is that okay, happy? Sometimes not happy, not sad. And sometimes sad. So in the Arabic language, you're going to have those three cases. Sometimes the word is going to be marfu'un. Sometimes it's going to be mansubun, fatha. Sometimes it's going to be maksurun, kasra. The question is, when is it marfu', when is it going to be mansub, and when is it going to be majroor? So that is what we're going to discuss later, inshallah, later. But first I want you to understand this sentence. So every sentence that we have here, what we're discussing is a nominal sentence. So the first part of the nominal sentence is? Yes, what is it called?
Subject.
Very important. Yes, the first part is called?
Subject.
Yeah, but what's the... It's ismun, but the first part is called? In Arabic, mubtada. Okay, and the second part is called? Khabar. So remember, the first part of the nominal sentence, what is it called?
Mubtada.
Okay, and mubtada is the same as subject. So the first part is called mubtada. And the second part is called?
Khabar.
And what is khabar?
Predicate.
Okay, so all of these sentences, the subject of the nominal sentence is marfu'un. Okay? The predicate of the nominal sentence is marfu'un. And here, because it is a noun, but the noun is a singular noun, that is the reason why it takes a dhamma. Nouns are of two types. Sometimes you may have a noun that is singular, sometimes it is dual, and sometimes it is plural. So this is what I wanted you to understand for now. That all nouns which are singular, meaning it is not dual, it is not plural. If the singular noun is subject of the sentence, then it will take a dhamma because it is marfu'un, and marfu'un means nominative. So all of these words.
Mama, can you write that down, please?
Write it down?
Yeah. Explanation.
Okay, you didn't write it down. Limada. Why are you not writing? Write this rule down. Because you're going to need it. The first part of the nominal sentence. So when I'm saying the first part means? Yes. First part of the nominal sentence is called Mubtada. And Mubtada is the subject. The second part of the nominal sentence is called?
Khabar.
Is called khabarun, and the khabar is the predicate. So once you understood, first part is called mubtada, second part is called khabar. The other rule is both the mubtada and the khabar of the nominal sentence is marfu'un. That's what you have to remember, meaning the subject of the nominal sentence is marfu'un. The predicate of the nominal sentence is marfu'un. So, marfu'un means it is nominative case. Nominative. Just for now, understand it like that. The subject of the nominal sentence is marfu'un. The khabar of the nominal sentence is marfu'un. That is, we don't say al-qamara jamilan. We don't say al-qamari jamilin. We never say that. It has to be al-qamaru. All of these sentences. So that's what marfu'un, meaning it is nominative case with a dhamma. Okay? Good. So the write that down. Got it? So the subject of the nominal sentence is marfu'un and the predicate of the nominal sentence is marfu'un. Now that we understood that, now we can fly through all of the sentences. Who's ready to start? Who wants to read the first sentence? Yes, masmuka. Ya waladu. Oh, ya rajulu. We got al-qamaru jamilun. What it means?
The moon is beautiful.
The moon is beautiful, okay? Make sure you look for the moon.
It's a crescent, it's hilal.
Yes. You're going to look for the hilal, not the moon. Next sentence.
Al-baytu qareebun wal-masjidu.
MashaAllah, very good. Translate.
The house is near and the masjid is far.
Excellent. Yes. Next sentence, another sentence.
Al-hajaru thaqilun wal-waraku khafifun.
Good. Al-hajaru thaqilun. The hajar is thaqil.
Heavy.
Good. The stone is heavy. And the waraq is khafif. The paper is light. Good. Excellent. So now, just remember, this. What you have to do is just, now you know what the rule is. Why it is dhamma, why it is marfu'. Okay, we don't say al-hajara thaqilan. You can never say that. Is that clear? Next sentence. Yes, what's your name?
Muzammil.
MashaAllah, Muzammil. You like laban?
No.
You like laban harun or you like it baridun?
Baridun.
Okay, read the sentence.
Al-labanu harun.
Good.
The milk is hot.
Excellent. The milk is hot, so you like it hot. Good. Yes, next sentence. MashaAllah, we have one sheikh here. Who wants to read the next sentence? Yes, what's your name? Muhammad. Al-Qamisu Nazifun. Good. Now just remember, even the pronunciation is important because there are certain letters in the Arabic language that whenever you pronounce them, they are known as, yes, letters which need to be pronounced with the full mouth, like Kha, Sad, Dad, Ghain, Ta, Qaf, and Za. So remember these letters, like we have the word here, Al-Qami-Su, so Sad, full mouth. So there are certain seven letters which need to be pronounced with the full mouth. Excellent. The Qamis is?
Clean.
Nazifun, clean, good. So now that you know these sentences, the next thing is Tamarinu, exercises. اقرأ واكتب. I'm not going to go into the verbs now, but later on you will need to understand verbs. Okay, right now, today we've understood nouns. Because verbs, I will introduce it as we proceed, but just remember now that اقرأ means read, واكتب means and write. مع ضبط أواخر الكلمات. Okay, you have مع, and after مع it's ضبط, which simply means vocalizing its last letters. أواخر الكلمات. Because every word we have to know how does it end. What is the last, you know, the vowel ending? So take for example the first one. Yes, can you read? Masjidun. Say it loudly. Al Masjidu.
Al Masjidu.
So you understood what they need from us there? Do you know the difference between Nakira and Ma'rifa? So whenever you say, now if you read, you must be able to recognize when you are reading it, there is no vowel ending on it, so you automatically, you know there's no alif lam in the beginning, so now you can read it easily. Masjidun.
Masjidun.
Al-Masjidu.
Al-Masjidu.
Al-Ma'u.
Al-Ma'u.
Ma'un.
Ma'un.
Al-Baytu.
Al-Baytu.
Babun.
Babun.
Okay, if you don't stretch the alif, it will become babun. So make sure you say babun.
Babun.
Got it? Yeah, say it again. Babun.
Babun.
Just now somebody standing there, you say haza babun, but then you say haza babun. So you need the importance of pronunciation. Okay, after ba it's alif. You got it? Translate haza babun.
Haza babun.
And if I say this is my babi, haza babi, well, how you translate? Yes?
This is my dog.
This is my dog. Okay, just now somebody will think babi means something else. So you understand in Arabic what babi means? My dog. Haza kitabi. This is my book. So we're going to learn later on how do you attach these pronouns belonging to somebody, if something belongs to you. So that is going to come. And next one? Qalamun. Yes, good.
Al-Qalamun.
Is that clear? Qalamun becomes? Al-Qalamu. Read again loudly. Al-Kalbu.
Al-Kalbu.
Kalbun.
Kalbun.
Qamisun.
Qamisun.
Waladun.
Waladun.
Al-Hajaru.
Al-Hajaru.
Al-Waladu.
Al-Waladu.
Himarun.
Himarun.
الحمار
الحصان
حصان
حصان.
So that was important. As long as you recognize ma'rifa and nakira.